Good evening. My name is Elizabeth Rand. I'm one of the pastors at Monroe Street United Methodist Church, along with Pastor Larry Clark. I will be guiding us through our Good Friday experience tonight. I invite you, if you haven't already, to prepare a devotional space. Gather candles, 3, 4, 5, 6, however many you want, and light them in front of you. Find a piece of paper or a couple pieces of paper and a pen, and also find a cross, a wooden cross if you have one, or you can draw a picture of a cross on one of your pieces of paper. This will be a quiet, contemplative experience. There is no rush. You can take as much time as you need. We simply invite you to be with Jesus and to be with yourself. Be open to the thoughts and the feelings that rise within you. Trust that God's Spirit is present with you. And this night will be for you what it needs to be. Let us pray. In the darkness of this hour, Lord, be our light. By the breath of your Spirit, whisper the word of life that death cannot destroy. Jesus Christ, our Savior and life giver. Amen.
14:1-9. Now the feast of Passover and unleavened bread was the next day, and the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest him by a conspiracy and kill him, because he had been saying, "Not during the feast, or there will be a riot of the people." On that day, Jesus was in Bethany in the home of Simon the leper, and while he was reclining for dinner, a woman came with an alabaster jar of the finest ointment, pure nard, very expensive. Breaking the neck of the jar, she poured it over his head. Some of those present were angry and were saying to one another, "Why was the ointment wasted like this? It could have been sold for more than 200 denarii and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. Why are you giving her trouble? She has done a beautiful thing for me. Look, you will always have the poor with you, and whenever you want to, you can do good for them, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body for burial before the time. And truly I say to you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
The woman in our story lavishes love on Jesus as she anoints him with perfume. I invite you to reach out in prayer to Jesus now and lavish him with love. Tell him what life with him means to you.
And Judas Iscariot, the one of the 12, went from there to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. And when they heard this, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money, and he was looking for a way to betray him at the best time. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations in order for you to eat the Passover?" And he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city. A man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." And the disciples set out. And they went into the city, and they found everything just as he had said to them, and they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, he came to the 12. And when they had reclined and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me who is eating with me." They began to be deeply grieved and said to him one after the other, "Not me." He said to them, "It is one of the 12 who is dipping bread with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born."
Jesus trusts us to care for him and for his friends. We betray him when we break that trust, when we focus only on ourselves and not on the needs of others. So I wonder, who might Jesus be trusting you to care for now? Who might Jesus be trusting me to care for now? Let us ponder this, and we may do some writing about this as we imagine the ways in which Jesus trusts us and how we might betray that trust.
And while they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take it. This is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, never again will I drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus says to them, "You will be offended and run away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee." But Peter said to him, "Even if they are all offended and run away, not me." Jesus says to him, "Truly, I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows two times, you will deny me three times." But he said vehemently, "Even if I must die with you, I will never deny you." And all of them said the same thing.
The disciples promised to never leave Jesus, to always be by his side. What promises are you making to Jesus that you can't keep? I invite you to write these promises down now.
They come to a place called Gethsemane, and he says to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he takes with him Peter, James, and John, and he began to be distressed and troubled. And he says to them, "My soul is deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground, and he prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup from me, but not what I want, but what you want." And he comes and finds them sleeping, and he says to Peter, "Simon, sleeping? Couldn't you stay awake 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And again he came and found them sleeping, because their eyes were very heavy, and they didn't know what to say to him. And he comes the third time and says to them, "Still sleeping and taking your rest? It is received. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's go. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
Reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, verses 43 through 50. And immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him immediately and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as against an insurrectionist? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." And all of them deserted him and fled.
The disciples broke their promise to Jesus. They deserted him in his hour of greatest need. They abandoned him. I wonder, when has walking with Jesus been too hard for me? When has it been too hard for you? When did it just feel easier or safer to go your own way? I wonder this for myself too. I invite you to meditate on this. Look deeply into your heart. Tell the truth and write about it if you wish. As Sam tells the next part of our story, I invite you to listen with your hands covering your mouth as Jesus is silenced by his accusers.
A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth, and they arrested him. But he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes gathered together. And Peter followed at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself by the light of the fire. Now the chief priest and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus, to put him to death, but they found none, because many bore false witness against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard this man say, 'I will destroy this temple made with hands, and in 3 days I will build up another not made with hands.'" But even on this, their testimony did not agree. And the high priest stood up in their midst and questioned Jesus, "Have you no answer? What are these charges they are bringing against you?" But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest questioned him and said to him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed?" But Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." And the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard this blasphemy. How does it look to you?" And they all condemned him as deserving death. And some began to spit on him and blindfold him and strike him and say to him, "Prophesy." And the guards took him away, beating him.
Let's ponder these questions. How do I silence Jesus today? How does the church silence Jesus today?
Meanwhile, Peter was down below in the courtyard, and one of the servant girls of the high priest came by, and when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "And you were with that Nazarene, Jesus." But he denied it, saying, "I don't know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt, and the cock crowed. And the servant girl saw him and began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." And again he denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, because you are Galilean." But he began to curse and swear an oath, "I do not know this man that you are talking about." And immediately the cock crowed a second time. And Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And beating upon himself, Peter wept.
As Peter buries his face in his hands and weeps, let us weep with him and pray.
immediately, early in the morning, the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes, and the whole council prepared a plan. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. And Pilate questioned him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" But answering him, he said, "You say so." And the chief priests accused him of many things. So again, Pilate questioned him, "Have you no answer? You can see how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus gave no answer, so Pilate wondered. Now at the festival, he used to release for them any one prisoner for whom they asked. And there was a man called Barabbas in prison with the insurrectionists for murder during the insurrection. And the crowd came up to him and asked Pilate to do that for them according to his custom. And Pilate answered them and said, "Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" Because he knew it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests incited the crowd and instead asked for Barabbas to be released to them. And Pilate again answered and said to them, "What shall I do with this man you call the king of the Jews?" And they shouted, "Crucify him!" Pilate said, "What has he done that is so evil?" But they again shouted vehemently, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wanting to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas, and having flogged Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Crucify him!
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 The soldiers led him into a courtyard of the palace called the Praetorium. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak. And on his head, they put a crown woven with thorns. And they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him with a cane, and they spit on him. And kneeling, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they unclothed him of the purple cloak and reclothed him in his own clothes. And they led him out to crucify him. And they compelled a passerby who was coming from the country, Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they carried him to Golgotha Place, which means the place of the skull. And they gave him wine mingled with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him, and they divided his garments, casting dice on them to see who would take what.
Thank you. It was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Judeans." And with him they crucified two insurrectionists, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagged their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests mocked him to one another with the scribes, and they said, "He saved others, but he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross so that we may see and believe." And those who were crucified with him reviled him. The sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders heard it. They said, "Listen, he is crying for Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and held it up for him to drink, saying, "Wait, let's see whether Elijah will come and take him down." But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God."
I invite you, and would you invite me, to write a prayer of confession and then lay your prayer on your table next to the cross.
There were also women looking on from a distance, and among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the Younger and Joses, and Salome, who followed him when he was in Galilee and served him, and many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening came, since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also waiting for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. And Pilate wondered if he were already dead. And summoning the centurion, he asked him if he was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion, he granted the body to Joseph. And Joseph brought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, he wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock, and rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. And Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joses, saw where the body was laid.
You.
Let us pray. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us.